welcome to another fascinating presentation by my colleague, Professor Joseph DiMento. Professor DiMento is an expert on international environmental law, and his presentation is going to provide some of the broader context of international marine conservation law to the conversation. He's going to be speaking about the law of the sea, some of the regional sea programs, and some of the emerging issues in marine conservation law. Professor?
Thank you for attending our sustainability series, which continues in the next academic year with a focus on the Arctic region, followed by a focus on the California coast. As Alex said, I'm going to give a broader overview of governance of the world's waters. We're talking about a resource that encompasses 70% of the surface of the globe. Bringing it closer to home, the maritime zones of the United States encompass almost 4 billion acres, which is two times the land acreage of the country. Today we learned that there are very different ways to promote protection of some of these waters. Those in the Colorado River Delta, those that are home to the great gray whales and whale sharks and so many other resources off the coast of Mexico. My work addresses governance of some of these and of other waters. When you think of it, how do you govern this or this, the Delta? Or this land-based pollution off of many of our coasts? Or this, one of the great regional seas that Alex said I will be talking about. Today I want to talk about successes and failure of governing the great seas. I begin with the law of the sea and then move to the law of the giant regional seas. I mentioned the Gulf of Mexico because of the recent disaster there that has been referred to, we all know. But my regional focus is an area far away that I've come to really love, and that's the Black Sea. Is there really law of the seas? Yes. So we just made up for the time, and I can sit down. I'll go on. What is the formal law of the sea? And if you believe that law must possess some decent probability of reaching its goals, there are a lot of questions about the return of the resources on the basis of the actions brought by Oceania. To be truly law, does there have to be some decent possibility of these governance actions achieving their goals? And if so, how do the laws of the seas stack up? The laws of the sea have been around for hundreds of years. Law in the international context includes customary law. These are some of the problems that we're all talking about, Oceania and others. Customary international law results from a general and consistent practice followed by nations from a sense of legal obligation. I just finished a course on international law at the law school, a wonderful experience. One of the big challenges was trying to get around the concept of there can be law without big legislatures, without formal lawmaking processes. But there has been a law of the sea for many years, and customary law, 500 years. Some of that law has been codified, made into treaties, by several United Nations treaties. These efforts culminated in 1994 in the entering into force, that is to say, becoming international law, of the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, or UNCLOS, UNCLOS. Talk about law. In the seas, most activities that demand law occur, as they do on the land, with the nation states. People steal from each other. People kill each other on the seas. People pollute our focus. They pollute on purpose. They pollute by mistake. They pollute by really bad mistakes. They kill wildlife. They disagree as to who can do what in a given territory and whose territory it is. The waters suffer from these acts, intentional and otherwise, in ways that affect us all and affect the natural environment. I was chatting with some colleagues and friends the other night, and it affects us all in many ways. Those of us who swim at Huntington Beach after a storm probably should not. Those who have the great fortune of being able to go out in their yachts try to stay away from the pirates these days. And those who live on Balboa Island, some of you are here, you know what you can face, and if, as we all believe, global climate change will affect the sea level. More focused on this international perspective, our concerns are on protection of the coral reefs, the wetlands, the great, wonderful sea turtles and marine mammals, living resources being over-harvested, and the environmental stresses on the oceans. One of the major sources of and major issues has to do with things that we don't at first think about when we think about environmental pollution in the oceans, and that's land-based sources of pollution, which, as I'll elaborate a bit, is one of the most serious elements of the degradation of the great waters. Municipal, industrial, very serious problems of agricultural waste. Shipping and sea-based pollution. The immense overdevelopment of the coasts. The vulnerability of the small island states. To elaborate a bit, runoff from cities, industry, and agriculture brings pesticides, heavy metals, and other substances to the great waters. It kills the fish, marine mammals, seabirds. It leads to closed beaches. Shipping across the waters leads to dumping, some unintentional, some deliberate, which destroys marine life, and as we're seeing, wreaks havoc with productive human activities. Invasive species are carried across the oceans and the seas by ships, sometimes unknowingly, to do substantial damage. Coral reefs are harmed by many insults, climate change among them, climate change which also harms the coast and leads to erosion. Wetlands and their productive and protective practices are destroyed. Exploration for resources and their exploitation leads to hundreds of accidents every year, which pour oil and toxics into the water. The United States Law of the Sea works in a fascinating way, the United Nations Law of the Sea. The main principle that the convention employs is zoning. The nations of the world, most of them, over 150, agreed to create demarcations of the water, regulating what can be done within each of the limited areas. This pretty slide shows the zones. These make good sense when evaluated by the central concept that addresses international law. A willingness of a nation, a country, or a state to give up a bit of its sovereignty. Sovereignty means that a state or a nation is the sole determiner of the rules which guide its behavior. And yet we're talking about international law. International law recognizes each state as equal and with authority to determine law for its citizens, except with regard to some universally abhorred actions. And even those do not give rise to international actions. International law to stop these behaviors except in very limited circumstances. In these zones, from the internal waters to the high seas, there is decreasing coastal state authority as you move out. But reflecting the negotiating power of the coastal states, the great powers and the navigating powers, several zones are governed to some extent by the coastal states. So in the territorial waters and these contiguous regions up to about 24 nautical miles from the determined boundaries, which is itself a matter of international negotiation, the coast state can set rules regarding fish catch, health and safety, approaches to fishing, as we just saw, and customs and immigration requirements. As we move farther out, the setting of boundaries gets a bit more complex. Part of the zone, which is determined by the topography of the nation states, how the land mass becomes the sea bottom, the form of its continental shelf. The law of the sea defines a great percentage of these areas as the exclusive economic zone. Here, this coastal state can exploit the fishery and other living resources and non-living resources in the water, the seabed, and the subsoil. Coastal states have in their exclusive economic zones two kinds of authority: sovereign rights over the natural resources and the water column, chiefly the fish, and jurisdiction over activity affecting those resources, including so timely offshore platforms and artificial islands, marine pollution prevention, and marine science research. Nature did not provide the non-coastal or landlocked states direct access to the seas, but they, of course, are interested in and technologically capable of getting to the seas, technologically capable. The law of the sea helps them to legally do so and includes the rather quaint notion that the coastal states should share the excess bounty of the economic zone within non-coastal states. The potential for controversy over the zones, as you can imagine and have read about, is immense. All kinds of fights, including tuna wars and other kind of fish wars. But there are increasingly available international approaches for assisting to resolve these conflicts. These are the leaders of Russia and Norway earlier in the month resolving a 40-year-old dispute over dividing the Barents Sea and part of the Arctic Ocean into economic zones extending to the edge of Europe's northern continental shelf. Among the most intriguing and for some time most controversial issues of the law of the sea is how to govern the high seas, the area. Which rules, laws, should manage the area beyond the continental shelf? If you stop for a second, you might ask yourself, some of you have done this, of course, but it's an intriguing question. What seems fair to you? What seems practical about access to exploitation of use of the resources beyond the zoned areas? This deep ocean region, and the estimates of how much there is really vary considerably depending on demarcations of the zoning that we just talked about, is called the area. It's subject to the notion in international law that it is part of the common heritage of mankind, the common heritage of mankind. It is a commons. How one, whoever one is, whatever institutions are, manages a commons is among the most fundamental questions in environmental law. The law of the sea says all rights in the resources of the area are vested in mankind as a whole, on whose behalf the authority shall act. These resources are not subject to alienation. The minerals recovered from the area may only be alienated in accordance with this law. The major sources and the major highly advanced nations from the point of view of technology worried about this provision. The law of the sea decided the area would in part be managed by something called the Enterprise. The Enterprise, located in Jamaica, would engage with nation states and other entities to mine and exploit what have been considered very rich resources of the area. The wealth deriving from that management would be shared globally. When the concept was first being considered in the international negotiations, one of the ambassadors pointed out the potential richness associated with mining the deep sea for nodules that contained very important metals. And at the time now, 30 to 40 years ago, the notion was that this could supplant and or complement the need for mining on the lands. Very controversial notion. In subsequent negotiations and an agreement in 1995 had tried to make for a more palatable scheme, including one that the United States might enter. What about the giant waters that are not oceans, the great seas of the world? They're also governed and to a limited extent have their own law. The United Nations Environment Program in 1974 began a project called the Regional Seas Program. This aims to bring together nation states and non-governmental organizations, civil society, as some people call it, scientists and engineers to manage the environment of the great seas shared by many different countries. Here, governance is part international law, part international cooperation, some forms of government, and unfortunately, part international indifference. There are now 140 countries involved in some programs under the United Nations or its cousins' environmental programs. And you could see the areas that are covered throughout the world. The idea is that the nation states should cooperate through action plans adopted by the member governments and create strategies for protecting the environment. But they also have moved, some of them, 14 of them have moved in the direction of making international law, treaty development. And here, things begin to look a little bit more like the traditional nation-state lawmaking, where you have secretariats or executives, regional coordinating units, lawmaking activities. The problems of the regional seas are truly daunting. The Black Sea is my sea, in the sense that it's one that I've been studying a lot. It's the drain for industry and agriculture for hundreds of millions of Europeans. I hope you don't mind this, but it is true. It is the toilet and trash barrel for millions of Turks, with a major lack of sewage treatment and treatment of municipal waste. It's a major highway for ships carrying oil to the west. It is a place where invasive species are very happy. They feel comfortable and have multiplied to really bad science fiction proportions. This is our friend the Nemiopsis. It's an invasive species. It was introduced into the Black Sea in the 1980s. And at a point when I first started studying this, the Black Sea was considered to be in an irreversible state of degradation. And it's almost beyond belief, but the population of these critters reached a high level of more than 10 animals per cubic foot. And this caused a dramatic drop in the ship fish populations, notably anchovy. Some good news and some bad news. They seem to like the Caspian Sea as well, and they've been found in recent years in the North and Baltic Seas. This is a satellite picture of the point where the River Dniester flows into the Black Sea at Ukraine. For effective governance of the waters, the link between the law of the sea and the laws of the regional seas and the many other international efforts that are ongoing to address the types of problems we're interested in, the activities of the International Maritime Organization and many, many other regional bilateral treaties have led to some interesting questions about how all of this works together. Part 9 of the Law of the Seas addresses this to some extent, but in a very, very general way. It talks about the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, talks about enclosed or semi-enclosed seas. It says, and again, very generally, the states should cooperate with each other. They should try, they should endeavor directly or through an appropriate regional organization to coordinate management, conservation, exploration, and exploitation of the living resources. Very general words, coordinate, cooperate. Some of the issues that arise include issues of jurisdiction. A regional sea may see the coastal state's exclusive economic zones overlap within the sea or on the ocean. One way of looking at this then is that ideally the regional sea's law and governance can fill in the gaps in environmental protection left by the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Seas. Since most regional seas are within the 200-mile exclusive economic zones of the Law of the Seas. So one way of looking at this is that with proper cooperation, the regional seas may play a much greater role in protecting the marine areas beyond national jurisdictions. But the relationship between these two regimes of governance, the law of the sea and the regional seas, leads us to ask questions about, is this a problem of law, or is it a problem of absence of cooperation and coordination? At UCI, for decades, even before the law school, with the School of Social Ecology and the Department of Law and Society and Criminology, Anthropology Department, we've studied not law only as it is made, but law as it works. Does it matter? To what extent has the legal architecture that I've so briefly described contributed to the sound governance of the great waters? Is the law effective? First and most commonly thought of about effectiveness, and this was the gist of some of your questions, are the resources coming back in the areas that my colleagues were describing? Physical parameters. To what extent have actual environmental conditions changed or been improved on the basis of principles implemented under the law of the sea or activities undertaken under the action plans and the treaties of the regional seas? The record is very mixed. In my sea, the Black Sea, for reasons that include those that have little to do with law, unfortunately, for example, some areas throughout the world have become much cleaner because the economic engine has completely stalled. So areas with clean air now are areas that were ex-Soviet industrial areas. The Black Sea, for reasons that do include some elements of the regional seas impact, Some conditions have improved. The huge invasion of the squid has moved elsewhere, and some fisheries are recovering. In other seas, the records are either immensely more impressive, like the Baltic Sea, constantly changing, like the Mediterranean Sea, which was the first of the regional seas programs and was the model for approaches to using cooperation across countries as varied as Israel and Libya and France and Italy and Spain, to bring them together to try to come to grips with the very serious degradation of the Mediterranean in the post-World War II area. Very mixed situation there. In some areas, the results are really deeply discouraging, with treaties being entered, action plans being written, people meeting in international meetings, and nothing happening on the ground. And some of my graduate students are addressing this problem in the Southeast Asian seas and that of Western Africa. How about the UNCLOS? With regard to the overall impact of the oceans, some fisheries are recovering. Pirating or piracy is flourishing. Garbage patches the size of some states are floating around. So very mixed record. Effectiveness at a less demanding standard could be addressed by, have there been important contributions to the development of international law? And here the record is pretty good, with many legally required legal instruments that potentially, as they evolve and people begin to understand them, and non-governmental organizations and activist groups like Oceana begin to make use of them, can be effective in influencing the behavior on the ground or in the water. And then thirdly, effectiveness indicated by improved relations among the states and the peoples. And here the situation is promising, again, with always the question, does more planning, increased collaboration lead to physical changes in the seas? One of the very big positives is the greater public awareness of the problems associated with the oceans and the seas. And those of you who were lucky enough to be with us last night saw the impact of the impact of the media and sound dedicated activists who use film to be able to influence the way we view our resources. Can the law be made more effective to make the record more positive? My own view is that, with a few exceptions where gaps could be filled for specific international treaties like the transport of hazardous waste in some of the regional seas, we really have enough law. In fact, some of my colleagues have talked about part of the problem being too much law, and that there is a procedural fragmentation caused by a plethora of conflicting and overlapping jurisdictions. And some have even argued that some of the overlay of the law of the sea has interfered with better approaches to governance of the sea. This, of course, is completely unreadable, but it shows some of the problem of the overlapping nature of the governance of the seas. And I spend years trying to sort this out with my graduate students, and it is a remarkable plethora of sometimes competing, perhaps hopefully sometimes cooperating approaches. There are some reasons to be optimistic. There is some good news. Marine life in regions like the Baltic is coming back. There's been a lot of collaboration among many of the nation states who used to fight over fish, fight over resources, and still fighting over access to oil and other minerals. There's been some, as I said earlier, very strong interest in planning on the coastal areas and in the seas, greater public awareness, more some instruments legally that we hope will eventually be employed in ways that are meaningful. There also has been, in a very interesting way, and some people at UCI have spent many years trying not only to study this, but to promote it, using approaches to environmental protection to bring nations that are in conflict together, using protection of the waters, protection of the environment, as a way of learning to work with each other. And this has happened in the Black Sea area and in the Red Sea. There probably is even reason to think that there will be better news in the future if we can get our governments to commit sufficient and reliable both financial and human resources to these areas to make environmental protection a priority in international activities. We're learning more and more about approaches to resolving disputes in the areas of the commons. There are now several approaches, several venues that you can go to resolve problems between Norway and Russia, the United States and Russia with regard to the law of the seas. There are international tribunals, one dedicated exclusively to the law of the sea, but those problems can be resolved through the International Court of Justice. They can be resolved through negotiation and arbitration. There is a fairly mature now set of venues where conflicts could be resolved in peaceful ways. What then do we need to do next? I think a few things as I close out. Emphasize in the law of the sea and in the regional seas programs the requirements of environmental protection. When the law of the sea negotiations began over 50 years ago, the environment was not a major concern. It was navigation, it was anti-pirating, it was exploitation. But over the years, through amendments and other means, environmental protection and marine conservation has become a central part of the law of the sea. We should remind our leaders that that's the case. On the other hand, I think we should recognize in the regional seas programs that they aren't only focused on the environment, that poverty alleviation and sustainable development need to be acknowledged and addressed as to their compatibility with environmental protection. One of the problems in those areas that I mentioned where the regional seas are completely programs are put together and then ignored is the concern by leaders and industry of the need for economic development with much lower priority for environmental protection. And I think rather than as environmental-oriented people saying that we need to overcome that focus on economic development, we need to incorporate it and underscore the compatibility between environmental protection and economic development. Governing the waters needs to further take into consideration natural ecological conditions, pollutants, fish that are called straddling stocks, highly migratory species. They don't know the difference between Norway or Russia's economic zones. Two-thirds of the marine life is situated in areas beyond national jurisdictions. So I would say, third, we should continued efforts to develop concepts that have the natural system determining the approach to management. And that was asked in the earlier session, to what extent the approaches that are being used reflect ecological realities. And in this regard, a focus on the development of marine protected areas, as many international and non-governmental organizations are emphasizing, and we saw some examples of that. This picture is a picture of an LME, a large marine ecosystem, and it has been offered great influence in the Regional Seas Program, as leaders in those programs are beginning to look at them, of understanding the environmental challenges of the seas. These large marine ecosystems reflect the movements, the flows, the resource corridors of the areas at the coast. And they have been zoned and developed typically with about 200,000 square kilometers of analysis, where the highest productivity from an environmental point is found. These LMEs can be referenced by the Regional Seas Programs and perhaps provide a beneficial management and coordinating organizer. There's also work going on in something called the Global International Waters Assessment, trying to understand in a comprehensive and integrated way what is the health of the great seas. And this is an ongoing effort, and in a few years, the United Nations will be summarizing this assessment of the assessments. Finally, what we also need now is a commitment. As I said, I think there's enough law, there's enough good ideas, to implementing existing law, a commitment to stopping the pollution of the great waters and bringing water life back to sustainable conditions. Sounds naive? I don't think it's a naive goal, but it one that requires education of the kind Oceana is doing and many non-governmental organizations, but not only education of people like us who talk to each other, but of those who govern, to convince them that the laws exist, to let them know that they exist, that they count, and that the citizens want the water to matter. Even if that means, and perhaps this sounds naive, changes in the way we feed and warm and cool and move ourselves around. While it was not planned to be part of this program, we thought it would be like ignoring the elephant in the room if we did not comment on the Gulf of Mexico. Here's some information. You've all read about it. You read about it on a daily basis. We may be seeing the worst oil disaster ever. And the impacts are environmental, but again, they are socioeconomic. People's lives, lifeblood is being drained by the approach of the impacts of the spills. We might want to talk about the capacity of law to make a difference. There'll be many, many other questions that we'll want to raise with regard to this. The third one here, do we need more coordination? Do we need more executive influence? But there are others that relate to existing laws and their influence, the need for greater laws, the need for the kind of work that environmental activists do, not only in legislation and education, but in litigation, because we do have a large arsenal of approaches to address the nonfeasance and malfeasance associated with the Gulf. Thank you very much, and look forward to talking over coffee.